That previous quote is often cited in papers discussing high context communication, which is a term coined by anthropologist Edward Hall in the 70s to describe interaction and patterns among certain cultures, or within certain cultures. I really like the quote because it perfectly conveys the thought that in Eastern cultures such as Vietnam, the context of an interaction is much more important than the spoken word. Now, this can be really frustrating for those of us who find a fast, concise, and direct approach to be easiest, but among Vietnamese, sensitive subjects such as illness are going to be discussed indirectly with a lot of dependence on the use of metaphors. So while as a service provider or clinician, you may have the advantage of being viewed by your patient as an authority, you'll need to have developed some rapport and a relationship with them in order to be effective and especially to be given the information and history that you need from them and their support network in order to form an accurate diagnosis and an effective treatment plan. Vietnamese speech tends to be metaphorical in general. It becomes especially so when taboo or difficult topics are being brought up. The caregiver you're receiving history from may not feel comfortable reporting the latest changes in the elder's memory or cognitive functioning, and so you'll need to do a lot of probing and clarifying in order to determine what the latest symptoms are. In addition, keep in mind that in Vietnamese culture, correct etiquette during interaction is highly valued, along with the need to save face. So the nonverbal cues that we're used to reading in European Western cultures may not indicate the things that we normally associate them with. It's common for a Vietnamese individual, for instance, to smile or stay silent in courteous response to something. It's a courtesy, not necessarily an indication that they're pleased or upset, and the context will be key. It's the same with nodding, and unfortunately, you'll have to take more time and draw out the meanings by asking for feedback regarding your impressions in order to develop the sensitivity to context that will allow you to communicate well with Vietnamese patients and their caregivers. Context and understanding can be hard to reach if you're pressed for time, as most of us are these days. So the following are some tips that I think will help with rapport and relationship building that is necessary for an accurate assessment and treatment planning with your Vietnamese patients and clients. Bilingual practitioners and clinicians are, of course, the first option and best option, but most of you probably don't speak Vietnamese, so the use of trained interpreters is second best. Using family members as interpreters is okay if you don't have access to trained interpreters, but just be aware of the different levels of acculturation among the generations and the fact that they may not have the fluency with Vietnamese interpretation of health-related information and questions require. In some cases, the family interpreter may even feel compelled not to ask or interpret some of the things you're saying in order to shield the elder themselves or merely because they can't interpret the information correctly. As much as possible, familiarize yourself with the etiquette and accepted behaviors. With the generation that you'll likely be assessing, bowing and greeting, for instance, will be more appreciated and less awkward for them than a handshake. Also keep in mind that while humor is very appreciated, gregariousness and casualness, especially coming from a clinician, is not necessarily perceived by the elder as warmth on your part, but as a lack of seriousness. Showing respect for the elder goes a long way for relationship building. And how do you go about doing it? One way is to put an emphasis on courteousness and consideration rather than friendliness. Remember that the generation you're working with and its support network tends to be hierarchy-oriented, so that using titles of respect and following etiquette is very valued and appreciated. An easy way to do this is by greeting the elder and their family upon meeting them using their proper titles. And if remembering, for instance, bác, go, or chú, and if remembering the Vietnamese titles is too difficult, then an even easier way is to avoid calling them by their first name and instead to just refer to everyone as Mr. So-and-so or Mrs. So-and-so. Physical contact and greeting is to be avoided. I noticed that various providers have taken to placing hands on people's arms or shoulders or someplace equally innocuous with the purpose of putting the person at ease. Note that this probably won't have a positive effect on your Vietnamese clients and patients. One thing I can't stress enough is to figure out the family hierarchy. Even if the caregiver is an English fluent family member and knows the most about your client or your patient's history and symptoms, they may not be your patient's primary spokesperson. When considering this, keep in mind that in Vietnamese culture, the young, no matter how learned or willing, are supposed to defer to their elders. In connection to what I've just told you, is the need to determine who the actual stakeholders and decision makers are. Again, if the caregiver is not the spouse or eldest child, she or he may be taking direction from some uncle who's never accompanied the elder to your office, but to whom the rest of the family may defer to when it comes to discussing important treatment options or long-term planning. Once you've determined your stakeholders and have established the necessary rapport, use metaphors and concepts that they are comfortable with to inform them about the diagnosis. Please educate them regarding the disease and its symptoms. Give them an idea of what to expect in terms of possible behaviors and treatment issues that can come up and prepare them for the future. Ask the elder and stakeholders what they think about the use of artificial supports, such as feeding tubes and ventilators, before the decisions have to be made, and especially before the elder's symptoms become too severe for rational thought. Please emphasize to them that dementia is a progressive and terminal illness. And in the process of doing so, explain the symptoms that they may start to see so that the family and caregiver can recontextualize the elder's symptoms as dementia rather than the hallmark of bad karma coming to roost. Start early on with validating and making it okay for the caregivers to seek assistance and treatment for the symptoms by acknowledging the challenges that may arise around 24-hour care and that most people aren't able to do so without some sort of assistance. In some ways, the assessment and diagnosis of dementia may be the easiest part. The hard part as a service provider may be reaching this population due to the language barrier. My suggestions are to inform the staff and directors of community-based organizations and civic groups that are usually frequented by Vietnamese. Churches, temples, and casinos are prime examples, for instance. I really did mean to put casinos on there. You'll find a lot of Asians there. Because of the willingness of this population to access subsidized services, and because studies have shown that this population tends to somaticize a lot, doing outreach and placing language-appropriate material at medical clinics is also an excellent outreach method. Vietnamese media is also a very effective way of spreading information about dementia and your services. Almost every Vietnamese person you'll ever meet will be familiar with a popular serial performance show that's put out on DVD called Paris by Night. Or if you can afford or have access to a translator, Vietnamese newspapers, especially in the Orange County, San Jose, or Houston areas, are widely devoured by many monolingual Vietnamese-speaking senior citizens. In addition, there are also many Vietnamese associations which have journals that need well-written material that is relevant to the needs and concerns of the Vietnamese community. If you need an example of a successful campaign geared toward the Vietnamese community, I suggest you look into UCSF's program Sức Khỏe Là Vàng, which translated means health is gold. This was a program geared toward increasing knowledge and testing for cervical cancer, which has a high prevalence rate among Vietnamese women. It combined print and TV media along with presentations to various community groups and came to be very well respected and received by the San Francisco Bay Area Vietnamese community.